Hello, everybody. I'm Joanne Haigh, and we welcome our viewers and listeners in Barbados and around the world to another edition of Face It and Fix It on CBC TV 8, CBC YouTube and Facebook, and of course, Q 100.7 FM radio. Now, today on our show, we have Dr. Natasha Sobers. She is a senior lecturer in epidemiology at the George Allen Chronic Disease Research Center, GACDRC, and Dr. Maddie Murphy, senior lecturer in qualitative research, deputy dean in faculty of medical sciences. They join us to bring us up to date on the recently Delta variant that has been spreading and Delta Plus that we have been hearing about now in the UK. They will be showing us these information in graphs and charts. And you know that we've seen many of them on social media, and they will bring us some information as to how they came up with the figures and the projections that we now hear about. In addition, we also have Dr. Natalie Graves, lecturer and palliative care specialist, explains care after surviving COVID-19. And we all know that we have been hearing about long COVID, and later on in the show, we have a special caller, someone who is a survivor of COVID, young girl, former exotic dancer, and she wants to share her story with us. And she is also reaching out for help on the show. As always, you can call us on 228-5563 or send us a WhatsApp message on 228-5562. We welcome your comments on Facebook. Just type in CBC Barbados and leave your comments there. And of course, we encourage you to call not only about the topics that you're hearing about, but you can call us and tell us anything that's on your mind, things that you may need help with, and you want us to share with agencies in Barbados, and you're reaching out for help. This is the show that you need to call. When we come back, we will be talking about the Delta variant after the break. To Face It and Fix It. If you're just joining us, our first segment, we will be speaking with Dr. Natasha Sobers, senior lecturer in epidemiology, GACDRC, and also Dr. Maddie Murphy, senior lecturer in qualitative research and deputy dean in faculty of medical sciences at the UWI. Welcome to the show. Can you hear me? Dr. Natasha.
Sorry, good morning.
Sobers.
Good morning.
And right. Hi, Dr. Maddie Murphy. Can you ladies hear me?
Yes, I can.
Yes, I can hear you as well, but I would prefer if Dr. Murphy went first, but I have lots of noise in the background, which should go away. I'm about to.
Okay.
So, you know, I've been working
from home. That's fine. Dr. Maddie Murphy, welcome to the show. You are a senior lecturer in qualitative research and deputy dean in faculty of medical sciences. What exactly does the first part of that entail in qualitative research and its connection with this COVID-19?
Sure. So qualitative research, I think a lot of what you'll hear particularly in the news is around quantitative research. So you hear a lot of numbers, you hear a lot about surveillance and surveys. Qualitative research is really looking at the stories that people tell, their experiences, and really trying to understand what's happening on the ground from a very in-depth perspective, I should say. So really, you know, lots of things like focus groups and interviews is what we do that also lends a lot of context to what we hear when we hear numbers.
So basically you collect some data, get the information, and then you come up with the projections that we're hearing, because before the alarm was sounded, where we heard about that we would see about 500 persons being positive per day, up to 500. Up yesterday's report, we were at 381, I believe that being the highest so far.
Yeah, so it's a combination of things. So you hear the numbers, which are the projections, and what I do a lot of, because my background is in qualitative methods and also in public health, is sort of give the context as to what those numbers mean. So yes, we'll hear something like 381 or 382 cases, I think we had the day before. So, you know, putting that into perspective in terms of what's happening on the ground, particularly with things such as our non-pharmaceutical interventions, you know, the hand washing, the mask wearing, or social distancing, and how people are actually doing with that. And you know, the also with vaccination and sort of our uptakes on things like vaccination, and really then telling the whole story of what that means in terms of our numbers and in terms of the kinds of cases that we're having. So we're hearing the cases, but you know, what does it mean in terms of us having rising cases? Does it mean that we're not implementing policies, or does it mean that we need to implement more? Or does it mean that you know, we need to do more on the ground in terms of our individual responsibility? So we collect all of that type of information to help policymakers make decisions.
So far, you haven't really been off the mark. Well, you've been pretty much close. Dr. Natasha Sobers, can you hear us now, and do you have less noise in the background?
I have less noise in the background.
You're muted.
It was just a sanitation truck.
I believe you're muted.
I could hear absolutely.
You're muted.
Oh, I didn't think so.
There you are.
Hi. Okay, there I am.
I couldn't hear you just now, but there you are. Welcome
so
to the show.
A sanitation truck passing. Thank you so much for having us.
And we want to say good morning to them too, because they also have a job to do. So that's all right.
Absolutely.
Epidemiology, lecturer in epidemiology. Just give us a quick, you know, rundown on what you do, because some people listening right now may not know what is epidemiology.
Yes. So, and I think before the pandemic, most people stumbled on the word and thought that I dealt with the skin. So they said, oh, derm, deep, something like that. So generally in epidemiology, we study trends in diseases. So we look at what are the most common diseases, what are some of the factors affecting those diseases, who gets a particular disease, why are they getting the disease, how can we control and manage and prevent that condition. Generally, I usually work with chronic diseases because those were the number one cause of death for Barbados. But, you know, COVID-19 is here, and with 100 deaths, it is making it into the top 10 of our causes of death, because, you know, some of the top 10 causes of death cause less than 100 deaths per year. So COVID-19 is here. And so we're studying the trends in COVID-19. We're looking at what's happening before and how we can predict what's going to happen next. And we try to do the predictions so that we can help the policymakers, especially in their decision making. So the numbers are not always, you know, meant to be. People say that they get afraid when they see them, but they're meant really to inform policy and allow the country to prepare. I think that we've done a pretty good job in terms of the Harrison's Point and the QEH in terms of preparing for surge for what we've had.
So where are we now then with the Delta variant and COVID-19? Where are we now?
Yes, so I want to share my screen because you made reference to some of the graphs mm-hmm. that go around. And, you know, graphs generally are meant to tell a story and help us through. This one is not one of ours personally, but it is from Our World in Data, and they, you know, put up these statistics. And I chose this one because it would allow, I chose Our World in Data. We pull from their statistics as well, but this allows me to show you a Barbados within a world context. So persons have been looking at these graphs, and two things you get from this graph. One, you just pulling at Barbados right here, our numbers are pretty high and rising. So, you know, the Delta variant is really quite transmissible. So in terms of the numbers of cases,
if you compare it to what happened with us in February, and you just focus on Barbados again, but what happened with us in February, you know, compared to the Alpha variant, the Delta really is very, very transmissible. So that's the first story or the first message of this graph. Our cases are high and they're rising, and the Delta is sufficiently transmissible that we have to be to really reemphasize our social distancing and our masking and so on. The other message from this in terms of putting a Barbados within a particular context is that I'm showing some of the countries within the region, just a few, because the graph can get messy. So here you have Grenada, which really struggled as well with this Delta variant initially, and then I know Grenada is doing better. Antigua also struggling and now doing better. St. Kitts also had those rises and doing better. So another message, we will get over this. And the other message is that we are dealing with a global phenomenon. I want to show you countries that haven't quite gotten over it. So Georgia dealt with this Delta variant. Latvia still on the rise, just as we are. Those are places in Eastern Europe, and I can show you at least, you know, a belt of countries in Eastern Europe that are having similar concerns. So the second message then is that, you know, this is a global phenomenon. It's happening in the Caribbean and Eastern Europe, is happening all over the world in terms of us learning to manage and do well or do better with the Delta variant, because it's very, very transmissible.
No, I was just trying to figure out, so what are we doing? What are the other countries doing that are doing better that we aren't doing? Is there something missing?
So some of the countries that are doing about the same as us in terms of vaccination rates, the cases are rising, but there is this disconnect between the cases rising and deaths. So I want to put it into a context of, we need to get to a place where if cases are rising, we've disconnected it from deaths, so that we focus a little less on the cases rising and focus more on reducing deaths and not having that high death rate. And vaccinations will get us there. And also, of course, what we're doing with the health system. So actually, I wanted to show that in cases, we're pretty high. But if I may show you one other thing, just to show you that in deaths, and just go to full screen, in deaths, we're not doing that comparatively. In terms of the Caribbean countries, you're not doing that badly in terms of deaths. And some of that might be the vaccination things that we're doing right, first of all. Our healthcare system, and I'm saying this because if you look at the numbers, so we had 4,030 cases in the past 14 days. So that's where we're really worried, you know, these cases are not good. 36 deaths. Compare 736 cases, so their numbers are not high and they're
that's
not
Bahamas,
sure.
Yeah.
69 mm-hmm. deaths. Mm-hmm. Yes? 3,000 cases, 3,000 cases, 42 mm-hmm. deaths. So a little higher than us, but Belize, yes. Mm-hmm. Belize, a little mm-hmm. lower cases.
I just want to make sure we read it out for those in radio land, because there are people on the radio right now listening to us as well.
I apologize.
That's all right.
Thank you. I'll do it that way now. Mm-hmm. So Guyana, mm-hmm. half as many cases, twice as many deaths.
Yeah. 1,907 in Guyana, 70 mm-hmm. deaths in the past 14 days that
Barbados.
We're dealing with right now.
70 in Guyana, 70 deaths in the past 14 days in Guyana, compared to our 36 in the past 14 days. Yes? Jamaica, 2,504 cases, 187 deaths. Grenada, 292, 28 deaths. Again, Trinidad, if you go all the way to the bottom of the table, to Trinidad and Tobago, 2,800 cases, 97 deaths. So I know you asked, you know, what are we doing wrong? But I really wanted to point out first.
Or should I say, what can we do different and better? Because I don't like the word wrong. Yes.
Yes, it's true. So what I really wanted to point out, that we are doing some things right, because you know, these deaths are fairly well controlled, and some of the things maybe that we're doing right, if I would be the contact tracing. So I would say that people continue to present yourself to the health services so that they can identify who's a case early and manage you quickly, so that when you went to the isolation center, you're better able to get better care. So, you know, get tested, identify yourself, because, you know, that decision to open the Harris's Point and have that, you know, facility there so that, you know, we can manage many people, you know, that is a really good thing that we're doing. Right. Vaccinations, mm-hmm. we would love to be doing better there. But I also want to congratulate the 63% of persons who have come forward, eligible persons who have come forward for vaccination, despite their own fears, our own fears, come forward for vaccination. And so, you know, we can do better, because we want it to be 90%. If you speak to Dr. Ferdinand and Major Clark and certainly our persons who are managing the country, we want it to be 90%. But, you know, it's really good that 63% have come forward so far. And I think that you know, our vaccination rate might even have prevented some of the deaths that have been.
All right, I want to turn now to Dr. Maddy Murphy. Dr. Murphy, so what is your take now on the statistics and what we have been seeing in Barbados in comparison to the other Caribbean islands? And I could use one you might want to reference, St. Lucia. I don't know if you have recent information on what's happening there.
So I think, the first thing I'll say is that, you know, we can look at different countries and we can try and compare ourselves, but the reality is COVID is really a moving target. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, we need to be aware that, you know, very much like the very first graph that Natasha showed, where you saw lots of ups and downs and you saw lots of peaks, for example, with different countries, even when comparing to Barbados. The reality is that, you know, you can't predict when a country will have an outbreak. And, you know, because a lot of what we've been doing is predictions, yes, in terms of, you know, where our cases can go and how high they can go, and then hopefully how low they can go. But we can predict those based on our surveillance, based on the numbers that we have. You know, we use the information that we have from the Ministry of Health to be able to make those predictions and to make those projections. So we can make some predictions in terms of what's happening in country, but we have no idea when an outbreak can happen in our country or any other. I don't have the exact information for St. Lucia, but what I can tell you is that every country within the Caribbean has tried various different methods in terms of what can work and what can't. We've seen things from lockdowns, we've seen, you know, no movement days, we've heard about the safe zones in some countries, you know, Guyana and Trinidad have been trying those. Again, vaccination is something that, you know, all the countries have, and they're really trying to encourage people to vaccinate, because the idea is that, you know, we have to look towards the future. We're now in October, we're moving into the Christmas season. We know that people like to, you know, get together. So there's a combination of sort of, you know, the government policies and then individual responsibility. And where we want to move in terms of the future of looking at where we are is to have cases, yes, because the cases aren't going to go away. We're not going to get to a zero COVID situation. But the idea is that we want to be able to manage our cases. So as Natasha was mentioning about the deaths, you know, we have a low amount of deaths, and thank goodness for that. And what we want to do is reduce those deaths and reduce those numbers and get COVID to a place where we can manage the number of cases and, you know, have it be something that perhaps, you know, we're at a space where if we have the majority of the population vaccinated so that people are getting mild symptoms or asymptomatic, that they can actually be at home and home isolate and sort of, you know, get over their symptoms in the comfort of their home without having to get to the point of being on oxygen or on ventilators, being within the health system at that level, so that we can reduce those deaths.
Okay, we're going to have to take a break. But when we come back, we have a question that we want answered. And we're not sure if you can answer it, because people want to know, when you say that the Delta attacks 4 to 5 people from one person versus the Alpha, we're not quite sure exactly where that information comes from. How do you know it's 4 people, 5 people versus the Alpha? But when we come back, hopefully we can get some answers. We'll be back. Welcome back to Face It and Fix It. We're speaking to Dr. Natasha Sobers and Dr. Maddy Murphy. We're talking about the pandemic and the Delta variant. The question was, and I got this question earlier this morning when I said that you were coming on the show, and we saw the ad, the person standing up, and if they sneeze and there are four or five people in front of them saying this is the Delta variant reaching four or five people. But what's the difference between that and then the Alpha? So your statistics and your information, you collected the information for when it was the Alpha, but you've also done information for now it's the Delta. Can you explain how it reaches these four people, five people, or is this just a guess? Can it be 10? You know, is it just telling us, hey, you know what, it just reaches more people, but it just used four or five to show us as an example?
Yeah, so the thing about the how much people the particular variant reaches, it's actually a changing number. So we refer to something we call the reproductive rate, which is, and we talk about a basic reproductive rate, a reproductive rate where the virus is allowed to replicate and nothing is happening and so on. And if it is allowed to replicate, then for every one person who is infected, they would spread to four or five. And that number comes from observation. So it's not just guessing, but it comes from observation and modeling. So it would, let's say we are dealing with Barbados, we would look at a particular person in a household so that they have it, and we would see how many persons they spread it to. And we would look at the next person who was not maybe within that cluster, and we would do the same thing. And then you take an average. So one person, there's some people who one person could spread it to 10. And then there's another instance where one person might only spread it to 2. And then one person might only spread it to 8. But then we take the average of all of that to decide what is the overall reproductive rate of the virus or the particular variant. And so it's an overall figure. But the reproductive rate and how many people it reaches is not a static figure. It's not that Delta always goes 1 to 5 or 1 to 4 or 1 to 7. That figure changes with behavior and it changes with distancing. So, and immunity. So the Delta variant will reach fewer people if we are wearing a mask and if we're standing further away from each other and if we're vaccinated. So by behavior and immunity, you're able to reduce the amount of people that the virus, whatever virus it is able to infect by, like I said, behavior and immunity, whether it's artificial by vaccine or natural immunity by catching the condition. So just to say there's a basic rate there's just a flat rate, and then the rate changes as the epidemic evolves based on behavior and immunity. And if that makes sense.
Well, I'm going to make sure that our viewers and listeners, because we want to break it down somewhat. So for people like me, you're telling me all these things and I'm sitting down at home and wondering, so how does she get all this information? She calling people like me? She doing a survey? You know, she watching the news? She listening to doctors overseas? Give us an idea. How is all of this compiled? And are we included in getting this information, the average person?
Yeah, so for Barbados, we would use the Barbados figures. So that's why we've sort of been sort of spot on for Barbados, because other people have modeled for Barbados as well. Mm-hmm. But let's say in January, for example, the ministry collects, if they have every case that they have in from the ministry, they contact trace. And they it's very aggressive. So they contact trace and then they determine how many cases come out of that one case. And so, you know, back in January, they would have given a particular figure. And then when it changed, they also told us that figure. And then, so that informed the models then. And similarly now, they would feed back what the rate is. So they know how many people they are. Their aggressive contact tracing does that. They know how many people they are and how many people are generally infected. So we are using, you know, figures that are created on the ground, if you will. But the basic reproductive rate, that's not what we get from Barbados. The basic reproductive rate is from models that are done elsewhere. Australia has some of the best estimates of the basic reproductive rate because they have the virus very well controlled, and they're able to track people very, very well in terms of this person was definitely infected by that person and blah, 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 blah. So Australia has really good figures on that. So the basic reproductive rate we do get from overseas, but some of the changes we are informed by the figures here.
Okay, so we've been told recently that we are the highest per capita in the world. Is that accurate in terms of where the information came from? I'm not quite sure. But it also led to an advisory and a travel advisory for Barbados. Dr. Maddy Murphy, I don't know if you want to weigh in on that. Is this true, and how is that calculated? Because someone again asked me, and we got to break it down. But if we only got so many amount of people, how we could be the highest when the U.S. we see so many cases every day? And one of you could break that down for the public in terms of the numbers.
Sure, I'm going to pass over to Natasha to break down the numbers. But mm-hmm. what I will say is that, again, you know, this is, you know, it's a moving target. It's a very scaled thing, you know, in terms of our numbers, and those numbers will change every day. The information that they are using, I believe, is from Johns Hopkins, which, you know, there are lots of different data generators, you know, different universities and places that are collecting our data. And it's usually based on what is being reported by governments every day, and they collect that information and they put that into their systems. So I'll let Natasha sort of break down the numbers, but it's important as well to realize that these are not absolute numbers. These are rates, as you mentioned. So it's not based on our exact numbers of saying 381 or 382 per day, but based on the rate per 100,000. So I'll hand over to Natasha for that.
Okay, Natasha?
Yeah, I agree with you. I think people do find the per 100,000 a little confusing versus the absolute rates. So absolute numbers. So our absolute numbers obviously are not going to be very high compared to the rest of the world because our population is small. But our numbers per population, and we usually say per 100,000, are high compared to other countries. It's not currently the highest. But they are high. And that's why I wanted to focus on how we are managing, because there are countries, for example, in the UK and so on, they are moving towards, as the vaccination rates get higher, they are moving towards not thinking as much as about the numbers and thinking more about the management and the deaths. So our numbers are high. And what I don't like about that part is that they are rising. So we do have to change our behavior and so on to get those under control. But they are not, in terms of absolute numbers, the highest, you know, in the world, obviously.
Okay.
But they're, and even in terms of per 100,000, they're not the highest in the world either. Like I said, there are a belt of countries in Europe that have numbers higher than those.
So what can you say then to Barbadians and share with us what you might have shared with the government in terms of how do we manage this bit better? Where do we need to improve? And I don't mean the government, I need the population, no, the people. Well, that's the important part.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. It is the important part. And I think, you know, as Natasha mentioned, we're in a situation where we are at our peak. We're in the middle of an outbreak and we have rising numbers even when we're high up right now. And what we really want to do is bring those numbers down. I mean, I think people would like to see those numbers come down very quickly. There are so many different ways you can do that. We've been going at this for quite some time and we have to balance so many things. And I think that's the hard part, really trying to have that balance. Because yes, we're supplying evidence and you know, we can give that evidence to the government and say, you know, here's some information from the health standpoint, from the numbers standpoint and the surveillance standpoint in terms of what's happening with our cases and where we you know, where we fit in terms of the region, in terms of the larger, you know, the world. But the reality is that, you know, you have to balance things like mental health, for example, as well, you know. So I know, you know, people have been saying things like, oh, you know, are we going to lock down? And people are worried about that coming up to Christmas. It's been a concern in terms of tourism as well. But those kinds of decisions, you know, aren't to be made lightly, and also have to consider, will they actually work? Because a lot of this also depends on individual responsibility and you know, people actually following through with what is being asked. I mean, we know that the most basic things, as we've said, the mask wearing, the social distancing, the hand washing, you know, those things work. They do work. Vaccination, it does help. And especially in the sense of really trying to reduce the symptoms and also the amount of sickness and getting into the health system. So those are things that we have to keep doing. I know it sounds like it's such a long haul in doing these things, and people get very frustrated sometimes and very tired of it. But it has to become part of our pattern. And I think the more that we continue doing those things and, you know, whatever policy decisions the government decides to make regarding any other, you know, other things, you know, in terms of whether they lift or implement other restrictions, will also help, you know, once we have those basic things under control.
Mm-hmm. So would you say, this is the, we heard about waves, first wave, second waves. Would we call this like the third wave? And can we see it leveling off? And I'll explain why. If you have so many cases right now, and they're climbing, and you have a, then you're balancing it off with, let's just say 50, 49% of the population vaccinated. We do know that you can catch COVID again, but there's still some level of immunity, I would imagine, right after. Mm-hmm. So can we see some breather? Maybe in a couple of months, when we look at vaccinated versus the unvaccinated who caught COVID, and somewhere in the middle, the unvaccinated that didn't catch it, and create this barrier that would give us a little bit of a breather and see the cases go down. Does that make any sense?
That makes perfect sense. But we have been, you know, we want to say the positive and the, you know, optimistic thing, but we've also been sort of reluctant to say when the wave is going to finish, only because if you look at the Caribbean countries, like, there's a wide variation in terms of how long the outbreaks last. I would say this is probably our second wave. I wouldn't have called July really a wave, you know, it was like a ripple. I would call this our second wave. And I would say I agree with you that between the vaccinated and the, you know, persons who have been catching it, because, you know, we are only, there are cases out there in the community who would have caught it that we would not be aware of, we should start to see some downward trend. I don't want to say anything beyond soon. Mm-hmm. But remember that we took about 7 weeks to get to this peak. And we would expect that the downward trend would probably take us another seven to peter off, at least. So I would say, look at how quickly we rose, or how long it took for us to get to a peak. For persons who are thinking to themselves, well, look at how far long it took us to get to a peak. And we are kind of there now, because we've been about this 380, 300 something for about a week or two now. So, and then when we start to fall, we probably will take that about a good 7 weeks to decrease. Mm-hmm. So definitely the advice would be, yes, get vaccinated, but also in terms of mental health, support each other and try not to argue as much in terms of, you know, people are like, oh, but vaccinated versus non-vaccinated. You know, try to understand those people who don't want to get vaccinated necessarily. I still try to convince people, yes. But I had some fantastic conversations, and we agree to disagree on persons who don't want to get vaccinated. And that eases some of the pressure. It eases some of the mental tension. Persons should not be, you know, pointing at each other and talking about, oh, you did the wrong thing and you did this. And, you know, because persons are being persecuted for you know, mm-hmm. in the mildest sense.
It's a serious division, and it's a sad one.
Yes, it's a serious division.
And it's a sad one, you know. Mm-hmm.
for our mental health, we need to just get rid of it and just support each other as much as we can, because we are in this for the long haul. So as much as we can,
we want people to vaccinate, and you do, what would you want to tell persons right now listening to you? And the same thing you just said, you know, all right, you may be vaccinated, but you got your friends, your family that refuse to. If you want to encourage them not to say these harsh things, what would you recommend, though, for people to live together in a society that will be some vaccinated and some not vaccinated, but your family, yeah, your friends? What can be done in a safe manner? Again, we can't force people to vaccinate, and they choose not to, for maybe medical reasons, maybe just for religious, maybe just, I just don't
fair.
Want to.
Just fair. Yeah, just fair. Fair. Sometimes it's just fair. And so I would say, I'm going to let Maddie jump in on this for sure, mm-hmm, because this is all the qualitative side. Sure. Mm-hmm. But I also want to say that the persons who are vaccinated are also complaining to me that they're being sort of attacked for being vaccinated. So it's going both ways. And what I would say first step is to try to understand the other person's perspective. But you can't convince anybody much of things unless you understand their perspective. And at least let's try to talk. That's all. You know, mm-hmm, if you're unvaccinated, try to understand the vaccinated person's perspective, where they just want to, they're doing what they think is best to protect themselves. The unvaccinated, mm-hmm, perhaps, you know, you're trying to understand what is the fair, what is the rationale, how are you understanding the pandemic, and just understand first. So I would, okay, my advice would be seek first to understand.
Let's take a quick call before you ladies go. Good morning. Face it and fix it. You're on the air.
Hi. Good morning to you, Joanne, and good morning to your guest.
Good morning.
Yeah, I'd just like to pose two quick questions, please. I've heard the promotions indicating that the Pfizer vaccine is now available only to, I think,
persons. Younger persons.
Right, mm-hmm, right. So I want to know, persons who have had a first dose of their first jab of Pfizer, will they then be compelled to mix the vaccinations? One. And two,
no.
I am on the issue of persons who argue against the vaccinations and so on. Do you have an idea of what proportion of doctors in Barbados, or maybe even doctors who are members of BAP, have refused to take the vaccine? That's something I'm keen to know. The amount of medical professionals themselves who, mm-hmm, have declined to accept the vaccine. Thank you, guys.
Okay, thank you. Well, I guess we can answer probably the first one.
The first one's easy, 12 to 17, mm-hmm, and there are Pfizer doses reserved for those who had their first dose. When you come back, Pfizer is there for you. You will have a Pfizer second dose. You don't have to worry about getting another vaccine. Mm-hmm. The second one, I have some idea, but it's probably a question best asked to
Dr. Ferdinand.
Dr. Cave or so. Dr. Ferdinand might know. Dr. Yeah. Cave definitely knows who's in, mm-hmm, in the hospital. What I will tell you, Maddie wants to jump in. What I will tell you is that a very high proportion of physicians, certainly higher than the population, have taken the vaccine.
Yes, and that's
and
for
that
sure.
Is, mm-hmm. That is absolutely, I want to say over 90, because that goes to the numbers that I've heard, over 90% in terms, mm-hmm, of the hospital. In terms of the hospital doctors, it's much harder to get a feel for what's happening in the community, to be honest. Okay. And so that's maybe a Dr. Ferdinand question or a ministry question. So Maddie, do you know?
Yeah, no, I was going to say, I think it's I've heard the same as you in terms of the amount of health professionals or doctors that are vaccinated. But again, that's probably a better question for Dr. Ferdinand.
What we know 100% sure is that it's in the majority. That much we
know. It is in the majority.
It's in the majority. Yes. Well, one more call. I want to put in one more call for you, if you don't mind. One more call. Good morning. Yeah. Face it and fix it. You're on the air.
Hi. Morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to know, it's so strange. We hear a lot about the protocols of wearing masks, washing hands, social distancing, but never anyone talks about boosting the immune system. and tells people what they could do and things they could take. Why? Never. I think that's more important.
Okay, thank you. And
thanks for that comment. That's a very excellent. Good and a very mm-hmm. important comment, because I think one mm-hmm. of the things, you know, we have actually spoken, I guess, even internally quite a lot about is that, yes, you know, we're pushing all the non-pharmaceutical interventions, all the things around the hand washing and everything else that she mentioned. But, you know, one of the things we have to consider is boosting our immunity, our immune systems. And also, you know, we've already spoken about the fact that we're a population with a high rate of NCDs, you know, diabetes and hypertension and underlying obesity. And these are all some of the comorbidities that have been mentioned, especially when it comes to folks who end up at Harrison's Point. So, you know, we do have to also focus on these root causes and the things that can actually make things worse for us, and that can actually make your, make it, you know, if you did get sick, if you did get COVID, that can make it worse for you. So we want people to, you know, make sure they're still on their medications, make sure that they're controlling any of those underlying issues that they have. And absolutely, you know, we're back to the basics of eating healthy as much as you possibly can. Focusing, and that's why we've talked a lot today in particular about focusing on mental health, not just your physical health, but mental health, because it is really, really important to reduce your stress as much as possible, especially in a very stressful environment that we have right now.
Okay, and last question, because we do have to wrap up. 2022, I know we said we can't do it any level of accuracy, but you think we could see maybe a little breather in 2022? I'm not saying to give me an exact, but based on the things that we are doing now, home isolation, we've managed to put people in home isolation. We've got the isolation centers. We're masking up. Yes, we're seeing an increase because it's Delta. Is there anything at all that we can do apart from what we're doing that we can get the numbers down faster by 2022, and that's what, 2 months?
So, you know, it's of course, I mean, there's so many things we can think of that we can do, right? But everything has a pro and a con. Mm-hmm. Right. Of course.
Apart from a lockdown.
You know, so much of this is about behavior. It's about not just individual behavior, it's about our community behavior. It's really looking at you know, going back to what Natasha was saying in terms of understanding each other, and also setting rules and you know, in terms of how we interact. So it may be that we, you know, we have disagreements on folks who are vaccinated versus unvaccinated, but you know, in having discussions with each other about those kinds of things, we can say, okay, well, this is what we plan to do, and this is how we plan to interact, you know, and making sure that we're sort of doing the things that can reduce our risk of spread, because that's really what it boils down to, is reducing the risk of spread. You know, realistically, it's going to be, as Natasha said, you know, it took us a while to get to this peak, and it'll take us a while to get down from it. Unless you take very hard and harsh measures, you know, it's not going to just have a steep fall. It will take some time to sort of climb back down that peak. But the reality is, what we want to do is reduce the chance of having another peak, of going through another outbreak. And if we do have another outbreak, to make sure that it's sort of one that sort of a lower peak that can be managed, you know, oh, much better, I guess, in some ways. Not saying that this wasn't managed well at all. That's not what I'm saying. But just so that we have numbers that are manageable is probably the better way to say it. So that our numbers are manageable, so that we don't have to have as much stress on the health system, especially in terms of, you know, all the putting up of schools and isolation centers and that kind of thing. We want to be in a situation where we are managing at home much mm-hmm. more comfortably and easily.
Could we find ourselves in a situation where, because there are some countries that don't have access to vaccines as much as even we do in Barbados, so we are very lucky, I must say. Yes. Do you think that we can have or see other variants on top of the Delta? Because variants can do two things. You can have a variant that's not as contagious, not as bad, and one that is twice as bad. At the rate that we're going, people are asking, could this be something that could go wrong in circles all over again with something new that the vaccine might not even be able to recognize? That's a possibility. I don't want to put fear, but that is a possibility. Yeah. Because we are seeing, or we're hearing it with the Delta Plus. I think that's what they're trying to refer to it as. in England, but they haven't seen anything yet to suggest that it's worse or more contagious. No. So I guess my question is if we don't do what we're supposed to do, is there a possibility that this can go into something totally different and the new vaccine doesn't recognize it at all?
And I would say to that, you know, yes, but even if we do what we're supposed to do, it could still change because, the change in the viruses has not surprised the virologists. Yeah, the virologist said from the very beginning, we would probably need boosters, and this is going to change because that's what viruses do. They change, because they replicate so fast that with every replication, there's a possibility for change and variation. So yes, we are monitoring it. I think that in terms of thinking about the future, I think we have to maybe start to get to a point where we say, perhaps this will not leave us and it will maybe become endemic. But as Maddie said, we have to learn how to manage it appropriately, or how to make sure our healthcare system and our bodies and so on can manage this virus. So definitely agreeing with the lady who called and talked about immunity, building our foods, because that is something that, you know, I'm constantly talking about in terms of healthy foods and so on. So we do have to learn how to manage with the cases. We don't like the rise that we're seeing now. Those numbers are too high. But maybe there's a certain level of cases where we go, that's okay, we can manage that. Mm-hmm. I think it's a reorientation to say, you know, we can manage at this stage. This is what the system can manage, even if it goes on for another year. So it's about management now, and not, you know, ever going back to zero or even 10 cases.
Okay.
So it's about management.
All right, I've got to leave it right there. I want to thank you, ladies, so much for joining us. Dr. Natasha Sobers, thank you, and Dr. Maddie Murphy, thank you so much for coming on the show. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for having us. Thank you.
We'll be back after the break. Welcome back to Face It and Fix It. Our next guest is Dr. Natalie Graves. She is a lecturer and palliative care specialist. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I want to make sure because I have the correct pronunciation. So palliative care specialists, exactly what do you do for those watching and listening that have no clue?
Right. Okay, sure. So what I am is a practitioner, and I provide general palliative care. So it's very important for us to understand what palliative care is, because a lot of persons, they're just like you, and you should feel totally fine with that. It's a very confusing word. It's not a word that we commonly use. And it's really about caring for persons who face the challenges associated with life-threatening illnesses. So a lot of my patients may have diseases or conditions such like end-stage renal failure, or they may have advanced cancers, etc. But if care, we don't only provide care for the patient, but also for their family members. And the focus or the goal of care is really on quality of life. So if you have, say, for example, motor neuron disease, or you're recovering from a stroke and you have symptoms that need to be monitored, if you have a patient who has dementia, a form of dementia, for example, Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease. So we help families to cope with things like pain management, if there's loss of appetite, if there's difficulty sleeping, etc. So palliative care, there's a definition. I know many persons out there are probably taking notes, and I encourage you to take notes. If you want to, the definition that we use is the 2002 World Health Organization definition, and it says exactly that. It's an approach to care. The emphasis is on quality of life. It's for patients and their families, and we're about optimizing health. So optimizing health in all of its domains, especially when persons are very, very ill. And in the case of my case, I do that primarily in the community setting. So we go to persons' homes and we help them to set up care for themselves and for their relatives, etc. So that's what we do. And it's a growing area of healthcare in Barbados. Barbados is one of the few Caribbean islands that has a growing palliative care network. So if you were to go on, say, for example, the website of the Caribbean Palliative Care Association, you will see a directory of services, and I'm very happy to say that we have a growing directory of services in Barbados. So that's what I do in my clinical hat. Yes. I hope that helps.
Palliative care specialist, someone says, thank you, Joy, because I thought it had something to do with your palate. You know, Bajans is telling you about your palate.
Let me give you the, it's coming from the Greek, and the Greek is really to pallium, to cloak, or to cover. Mm-hmm. So you can help persons to deal with their pain, or to cover their pain, or to cover their symptoms, and to basically embrace them and comfort them to deal with very, very challenging things. So, yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah. Well, good. I hope that helps our listeners and viewers, and for myself too. In relation to COVID-19, and we hear about long COVID, and there's some people who actually don't believe in it. Some people feel that, it's a hoax. We've had some doctors on a couple of weeks ago, and all of them said the same thing, that, you know, there are symptoms. People have symptoms of hair loss, or experience hair loss, even erectile dysfunction for the men who, unfortunately. But so you want to tell us a little bit more about long COVID?
Sure.
And what has science been telling us? What have you been seeing?
So I think the thing to do is to build a strong foundation. You've probably been having programs like this over and over and over again. And I just want to set the foundation on which we're going to build the next couple minutes. So long COVID or post-COVID condition, it might go by another name, post-COVID syndrome, etc. We're really about the prolonged symptoms that occur after a person has had COVID-19 disease. And I think most of us are comfortable with the fact that COVID-19 is the disease that occurs as a result of an infection with the SARS-CoV-2 virus, which is what all of us are facing, the threat of that. So we know that we get that virus primarily by, you know, inhaling droplets, or, you know, being in close contact with somebody and directly contracting the virus from them. Now, usually, when a person has COVID, when they've contracted the SARS-CoV-2 virus, and then they have the disease, usually you can expect to recover within 2 weeks. Yeah, so that's the usual thing. Persons will say 14 days. So usually once you get the disease, you may become symptomatic within 2 to 4 days of having that disease, and then you have the ability to spread it usually within 7 days of having it. But then your ability to transmit it goes down and your symptoms get better, and you are basically, say for example, if you were in isolation in Barbados, you would be discharged and you would feel pretty much comfortable. So the usual symptoms that persons might have had might have been things like fever, cough, they might have had some chest pain, etc., when they were actively having COVID-19 disease. Once you recover, you would expect that those things go away. But what happens with long COVID syndrome, and what we're noticing, there's a set of studies that you can do called observational studies. So you watch people and you see how they recover. And what these studies are showing, especially for the respiratory symptoms, for persons who may have had COVID, but they've also had, say, for example, a bacterial pneumonia on top of that, or they had multiple comorbidities, or they were admitted to ICU because the disease was very severe, those persons are most likely to have long COVID. And what we're saying is some symptoms last for, instead of just 2 weeks, they can go on right now for 6 months. Obviously, the disease is still, you know, progressing quite a bit, so we don't know all that it is. But I'm going to give you the major symptoms so that there are persons out there who are listening and they may want, what are these kinds of symptoms that could go on? So for some persons, the cough that they may have, which is kind of like a more like a dry cough, mm-hmm. that can go on for sometimes a few months, up to 3 months, it's even longer. You may expect that you may feel extremely tired. And that's another one. So you're getting up in the morning, you're not quite sure why your energy is waning like that. You may not feel as motivated, which is something else that we're going to talk about. So fatigue, yeah? Mm-hmm. So the cough, the fatigue. And for some patients, up again till about 3 months, they can still feel a little short of breath. So say, for example, I'm talking to you and I can, for the most part, complete my sentences quite nicely. But if you notice that you're talking, you can't complete a full sentence, you've walked from a short distance or you've gone up a stairs, etc., mm-hmm. and you still find that you're short of breath, that may suggest that,
Exactly. So before we go any further, because I know it seems to be a little longer list, we do have to take a quick break, but it's shortness of breath, coughing, fatigue, the major one. We're at so far.
And the chest pain. That's the other major one.
We're at four so far. When we come back after the break, we're going to list the others. We'll be back after the break. Welcome back to Face It and Fix It. For you, for those of you who just joined in, we're speaking with Dr. NATALIE. And I say NATALIE because that's how I pronounce my middle name. Bitch, and say NATALIE, I call it NATALIE. Dr. NATALIE right. Graves, yes. Lecturer and palliative care specialist is speaking with us on long COVID. And before the break, we talked about some of the long symptoms one can experience, and that included chest pains, dry cough, difficulty breathing. Go ahead.
Tiredness. One I wanted to get to is what most people complain about, the a delay in their inability to smell. So basically what we call anosmia. So it's one of the symptoms that you might have noticed when you picked up that you were having COVID, but that that does not immediately go away in 2 weeks' time. Sometimes it can last for a month, 2 months. So that could be kind of frustrating because you can imagine, you know, eating your favorite cuckoo or whatever, or your favorite fried chicken, and you can't really smell it, which means then you can't really taste it, etc. So that can be fairly frustrating. But one of the things I wanted to really bring home is that with long COVID, they're just not physical symptoms. They're also psychological symptoms. And this goes back to the whole concept of community and getting as much help as you can. Sometimes when what we're noticing is that persons who've gone through COVID, you can sometimes have anxiety, overwhelming sense of fear, sometimes depression, and then there's a cognitive delay as well, meaning the way how your brain might work is not fully how it was in the first 2 months. So sometimes a little bit of forgetfulness. I think all of us, especially if we're sleep deprived, we may be a little forgetful.
Going through menopause. We are going through menopause.
Yes. You see me in my big white cloth. Anyways, that's besides the point. Anyways, so forgetfulness or difficulty concentrating. So you're doing something and you're not focusing on it in the way that you would have. That can also be a sign of post-COVID syndrome. And then there's something called Sika syndrome, which occurs otherwise, but it seems like it's also occurring post-COVID. And so that fancy name just goes along with the fact that you're feeling that your eyes are really gritty, or you're feeling that your mouth is really dry, or your hands, especially the small joints, et cetera, might feel kind of painful. And obviously there are some people who have really weird, post-COVID syndromes that are rare. And they're more likely related to things like inflammation in the brain that can happen. Some persons may have cardiac difficulties with their heart in the long term. But as I said before, this is very much a disease that is evolving. So it's important to recognize the symptom, not to be afraid of it. Don't doubt yourself and to seek help. And because COVID is evolving, many practitioners on the island are staying up to date with how to care and how to manage. So usually when persons are discharged from isolation center, they're discharged with a note, etc. And you can take that note to your usual primary care physician, and your primary care physician can help you to navigate your symptoms and what is needed. I think it's important to note that you may need to go beyond your usual general practitioner, usual primary care physician, and involve a multidisciplinary team. So especially if you're feeling lack of motivation, if you're feeling perhaps like your life is worthless, or you're having difficulty sleeping, or your appetite is decreased, or you're eating more, anything that would suggest that your mood is being affected as well, that definitely needs intervention from a psychologist. And some of the other things I think you mentioned before the break, you're asking about, you know, like erectile dysfunction and so forth. Mm-hmm. There's some persons who have a dysregulation, so to speak, or a change in the way how blood flows, venous blood flows back to the heart in certain organs. So the penis, let's just say, the penis is an organ.
We don't want to hide from it, gentlemen.
Yeah, and it penis. Has blood that flows in and blood that's supposed to flow out. Mm-hmm. And if you have difficulty with the way how blood is flowing because of inflammation or what we call blood clots, etc., that can also happen. But you can also have the same dysregulation that causes that occurring in your lower limbs and your hands, etc. So I think one of the things is we don't want COVID to be something that is stigmatized. Yes? I think Natasha and Maddie were talking about it before, the fact that we are going to have to live with COVID. And the more we normalize COVID, the more it is that persons will feel comfortable seeking care. One of the things that I'm very concerned about is persons who might have acute COVID, and because they don't want to be in the system, they don't want to get tested, they stay at home, and then sometimes they present very late. But also, if you've had COVID and you think nobody's ever going to know that I have COVID, and you're experiencing these things, is to say that there's help available. You can see a practitioner, and for most of these things, there are treatments that can be used that can help you. And persons would have talked in the previous segment about, you know, the lifestyle modification that is necessary for all of us to get through this pandemic. So optimizing our nutrition. We just happen to live in Barbados in what is called a blue zone, in that naturally we have a very good environment. So as long as we don't have, you know, limitations in our movement, if you've had COVID, get out into the sunshine. There's increasing evidence about the usefulness of vitamin D, relaxation in terms of for your mood regulation and so forth. So if you need to and you can, you get to the beach. I need to just take up my towel. I'm sorry.
That's all right. So what I was going to tell you to people watching, sure, people listening, mm-hmm, I can tell you 100%. There are people right now, when you talk about, mm-hmm, the symptoms and did they know they had COVID, I have girlfriends, boyfriends, mm-hmm, friends in general, mm-hmm, that say, Joy, I feel I had COVID, you know, blah, 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 yes, blah. And a lot of people, yeah, believe, yeah, that one, it was here even before they tested the first case in March. Yeah. People speak of the colds and stuff like that that they've had. But what I'm trying to hit at is, as you, mm-hmm, list the symptoms, there are people right now watching in Barbados and around the world and listening, mm-hmm, feeling for, wait a minute, my eyes are feeling gritty only the other day. And you know, I had to walk up them stairs and I had to out of breath. And girl, Mildred, 6 months ago, I had this cough and I was had this cold. There are people actually right now, as we speak, going through in their minds, I had these symptoms. Yeah. I can tell you one for one, the brain fog with me. I don't know if I had COVID. Yeah. I was never, yeah, tested that I had COVID, but I can tell you that I have been experiencing a level of brain fog, and I put it to menopause and not necessarily, yeah, COVID, because what you're saying, yeah, is the combination of these things could be related to COVID if, yes, you had it, if you knew you had it, but there are people who didn't know they had it, but experiencing, yeah, these things.
Yeah, and I think the thing, and that's where seeking your professional advice, because this is just a sensitization. It's not meant to be a diagnostic session.
Right.
So I'm not saying to persons, you know, this is what it is. I'm saying the things that we want you to be aware of. And if you're aware of these things and they're especially affecting your quality of life, you need to have a conversation with the healthcare who can help you optimize, one, understand what's the root cause, and then help you to optimize your health in that respect. So if anybody that is suffering from any kind of cognitive, so you're finding more forgetful, etc., you need to have a conversation. It could be related to, as you said, you know, menopause and fluctuations between your estrogen level, etc., or it could be lack of sleep. It could be related to B vitamins, B12 levels. It could be all kinds of things. But what we're saying is, as it relates to COVID, we now have thousands of persons in Barbados who are known to be, would have had, been diagnosed via a test as having had COVID. So we want persons to understand that even in their recovery, everything may not snap back to normal. Don't be panicked. If you're experiencing symptoms, get checked. But if you know you've never had a diagnosis, but I'm just going to be very frank. If you know you had every single symptom there was for COVID, but you never left your house, you self-isolated, you didn't tell a fella anything, but you know that you're still feeling short of breath, you know you're still having chest pain, etc., just seek help so that you can actually help yourself and help, and you, mm-hmm, could, you know, share the information in this program so others can be helped to get the symptoms addressed. So it could be COVID related. It could not be COVID related, so but help is available.
So you see some of the symptoms you listed, and I can tell you, yeah, most females would probably look at that and go like, okay, let me go and check or let me do something about it. Mm-hmm. Men don't normally go to the doctor, yeah, or they don't like to tell anybody, yeah, anything. But yeah, I want to focus on, yeah, the erectile dysfunction, because I believe, yeah, that would give them reason to get up and do something. Well, give them reason to do something about it. Yeah. So Yeah. Let's talk about that for a second. Is this an age-related lung impact, or could it be a male of any age catching COVID that could experience erectile dysfunction? Let's take a 30-year-old guy, 35-year-old person, male.
Yeah.
Can that happen to
him? Yeah, so sure. And I think the thing that we need to figure out why is why erectile dysfunction happens. Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to put on a different hat and just talk to the menstruate, okay? Mm-hmm. So erectile dysfunction, it can be a function of how the blood is flowing, but it can also be of your mind and how your mind is working. And if you're experiencing any kind of anxiety or stress, etc., it's going to be difficult for people, for persons to achieve and to maintain an erection. Also, know that many persons who have COVID also have comorbidities. So if you are a person who already has hypertension, or there's some already a disorder that is affecting the way how the blood is flowing to the penis, if you're on some medications that can also be affecting your ability to maintain an erection, and then you have COVID on top of that, it doesn't really matter in terms of your age, okay? There are some persons also that the minute that they experience an episode of having an erectile dysfunction or inability to quote unquote perform, as they may want to say, sometimes the psychological impact of that then causes you to have repeated episodes of erectile dysfunction without there actually being anything physically wrong. It then becomes a mind thing. It becomes a feeling thing. So this is why if you are having and experiencing erectile dysfunction in the context, especially if you've had hypertension or you are hypertensive and you are on certain kinds of medications, you need to have a conversation, because erectile dysfunction is something that can be managed. And if you have a partner and your partner understands what is happening and why it is happening, it does not need to take away from your masculinity. And although it's 11:13 in the morning, it doesn't have to take away from your sexual enjoyment and your sexual pleasure. There are different ways in which sexual pleasure can be achieved and maintained. And so I would encourage them to define themselves by their ability to have and or maintain an erection, and to know that, you know, there is there's a way to address erectile dysfunction so that it can be achieved, the sexuality that you want can be achieved again. Mm-hmm.
But so let me ask you this, pertaining to the vaccine and and the men that you're listening, if you're listening to us right now, and this is not a scare tactic, this is bringing the facts to you. Do you have any information, and you could wear your other hat, that the having a vaccine to protect you from COVID-19 will cause erectile dysfunction? Because we do have data to suggest that when you catch COVID, it can, and I know it didn't say 100%, it said you can experience erectile dysfunction. So do we have any information to say that the vaccine causes erectile dysfunction?
Right. So I think the thing to do is, and this is, let me just put it straight. Mm-hmm. Erectile dysfunction is not a known side effect of the vaccine. Okay? Right. Okay. That's just,
which means people, we don't have any information that we know of to support it. That's what that
But means. I would say that, I would also say, clock coming out again, I would also say that evidence evolves. So I'm not going to say, you know, but I find that to me, I've seen lots of very scary videos on WhatsApp that if I didn't have the position of knowledge that I have, I could say, well, you know what? I don't want to take this vaccine because I'm going to lose my... I remember seeing somebody send me something where the person lost their fingers. And the risk from the vaccine. And I would say, well, what is the evidence? Then you look up the stuff. They're hoaxes. They're hoaxes, so to speak. Mm-hmm. It's not valid. So I would say to be... Fear is real. And nobody can take away your fear. But you can also, whenever something comes to you that is fearful, just stop a moment and check it up and look it up. What I would say, though, is that thinking about a side effect of the vaccine, also think about the risk of this particular thing occurring should you get COVID. So say, for example, I'm just going to be very honest here. I don't know why I'm being so forefront in front of everybody in Barbados, but...
Please, it's called facing and fix it. That's the only way we do the show.
Okay. Well, thanks for that. So last year, just about a year ago, literally, I had... bilateral pulmonary embolisms, meaning I had blood clots to both of my lungs. as coming on to the end of my pregnancy, the very last day, really. That was one of the things that happened. So when the vaccine, as a healthcare professional, I thought about it, you know. I wanted the vaccine because as a healthcare professional, I would have been at higher risk, et cetera. But I had to think about, you know, I just had blood clots. Is it time for me to have this vaccine, especially if it is that it's query associated with a risk of, you know, thromboembolisms? And I had a conversation with my doctor, and she was very frank. And that's the same thing. It's like, what is the risk of getting a clot from the vaccine? Just getting a clot from COVID. And it is miles apart, so to speak. So the risk, it is so worth it to get the protection of the vaccine if it is something that you feel persuaded about. Nobody is going to force you. I think the government has been very clear about they're not going to mandate in particular sectors. For those of us who are very high risk, I think we have to understand our risk in the first place. So tourism persons and persons who are in the medical field, etc. And we also have to understand our responsibility to protect others. So to the man out there who is thinking about erectile dysfunction, also just think about this: what could happen if you have COVID in the first place? Mm-hmm. And what could happen if you then develop long COVID versus taking the vaccine? And I think that's one way to do it. Every time you hear something that the vaccine does this, well, look and see, well, if I were to have COVID, what would be the outcome? And which one has the greatest likelihood of causing me a problem?
Well, see, this is why I had to ask the question for the balance, because there are people who may say, well, look, if I take that vaccine, men I'm referring to, this will happen. But it's important for men to understand that these are the facts and this is where the science is carrying us. And no one said on this show that it was 100%. There's just enough evidence to support that it can happen. It has happened. And I don't know for how long, because again, everything with COVID now, it's only been what? Not even 2 good years. Going into 2 years of the virus, and information is still being collected to support what then happens afterwards. Yeah. And that not everyone to stress on the erectile dysfunction as we did, but it is important to note, and we know males that is an important part of their life, so sometimes than the females. And it is not a scare tactic, but it is a fact. So if it is that you can protect yourself by getting a vaccine to allow you to be better company for your partners, then maybe that might be some food for thought. But I want to get on to, you said long COVID, so we just move on a little bit from that on to long COVID. When we say long COVID, is it 3 months? Is it 6 months?
Yes.
Do we have evidence that it can go on for longer?
Yeah, so I think some of the longest observational studies are up to 9 months for some things, but most of the data is around 2 to 3 months for the major symptoms, and this can occur in almost, depends on really your range, but about 20% of persons can have one of the four major symptoms. So those four major symptoms are definitely worth repeating. So fatigue, shortness of breath, chest pain, and the anosmia. And that's the beauty of observational science. So we will continue to watch, continue to monitor persons and to see how the disease progresses. Okay. To come back to the vaccine issue, to just say that what we do know is that, as was mentioned in the previous segment, we're now positioning the vaccine as a preventative measure. Yeah? So you're talking about reducing the transmission from one person to the next. So you are reducing your likelihood of spreading it to somebody else, and somebody gets the vaccine, they're reducing their likelihood of spreading it to you. It decreases the likelihood that if you do get the disease, that it'll be very severe. And know that if you have very severe disease, you are more likely to get long COVID. So in essence, you can say by getting the vaccine, you are less likely to have severe disease, and less likely, not a guarantee, just as you said, less likely to have these long-term sequelae. But the bulk of the evidence is really in large studies that have followed persons for up to 3 months. And obviously, as time goes on, the period will progress, and they will have more information. But I think I think, although you, I like the fact that you have singled out the symptom as an issue, but you've said, look, generally, it's just a wise thing to do if it is something that you feel persuaded to do. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, we're going to leave it right there, Dr. Natalie Graves. I would love to invite you back because I think we have more to discuss.
We should do something on menopause.
Yeah, we do have to do something on menopause. Because there are other things that are happening out there too besides COVID. And I do want to focus on the males a lot because I think that we're probably seeing more females vaccinated than the males. So I heard, but I don't know. I want to get that information maybe from Dr. Ferdinand for another show.
Yes.
And to maybe see whether or not, you know, what scares them to get that vaccine and things like that. Yeah. So I want to thank you so much, Dr. Natalie Graves. Thank you.
Most welcome.
All right. Thank you. Our next guest is a COVID-19 survivor. She's on the phone, and I know that she's calling us from a cell phone, so we don't want to delay her any much longer, but we will take a commercial break and come right back, and we will speak to her live on Fixin' and Fix It. Welcome back to Face It and Fix It. My next guest is a young girl, 19 years old, a former exotic dancer, a mother of a 10-month-old baby, a COVID survivor, who currently reached out to us and we wanted her on this show because we wanted her to share her story. Good morning, and I have permission to say her first name. Brittany, good morning. Can you hear me? Brittany, are you there?
Yeah.
Good morning. You can hear me? All right. Well, yeah. How are you doing, hon? You're good?
I'm good. Are you?
All right. Okay. I'm doing all right for now. I know you're on a cell phone, so let me just try to make it as quick as I can. Last year, you got pregnant with your baby during COVID pandemic. What was that like for you, being pregnant during
it
the pandemic?
It was very hard for me because it wasn't working or nothing like that. Mm-hmm. And it was just me by myself with during the whole pregnancy or whatnot. So it was mm-hmm. very hard for me last year during the pandemic, knowing that I ain't got a job, mm-hmm. nothing like that. So I just had a virtual by myself.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then eventually, baby mm-hmm. came in what, December last year?
Yeah, he came December the 1st.
Oh, he's going to be a year coming up. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, so I know, I mean, we want to touch on you catching COVID and you're now okay, but before that, before the pregnancy, mm-hmm. take us back to what kind of work you actually had to do, and if you want to share that with us.
Well, before the pregnancy, I used to work in a club, dancing, mm-hmm. however, because work was hard to find in Barbados, it still is, but they say, because you don't have a job, work was very hard. And I just thought myself, well, I need fast money. Mm-hmm. So I just went and I danced or whatever and I got money or whatever. But mm-hmm. then, after I get the baby, and I went back, I didn't mm-hmm. like it. Like, mm-hmm. it just like, if a man come and touch me or whatever, it just used to crawl my skin, so I started crawling my skin and I never went back. So I just thought myself, like, I got a baby now and I want to make a better life for my child, and I don't want that when he grow up nobody tell him nothing about his mom because he only have me to look at her. Yeah, so
well, I can certainly understand that. And first of all, before we go any further and before any people want to place any judgments, let me make it very clear, you are very, very brave to come on this show and to let people know what you did for a living. Respect is due to you to let people know how you felt and that you don't want to do that anymore and that you're only 19 and that you recognize that that is not the life for you because you have a baby. So we can move away from your past. Let's talk about what recently happened to you when you caught COVID. And let us be clear, Brittany did not catch COVID in a club. Brittany caught COVID from a friend in the house. So tell us what that was like.
Okay, so like I was blaming my friend here. And she, after I done her, it's obvious that if it's my friend that she's been with me all the time, I ain't gonna let she put on her mask and stuff like that. It was just studying it. Mm-hmm. Right? So mm-hmm. I said her whatever. So she took off, she had on her mask actually, but she took it off because I was going here for a while, so she ain't gonna wanna be inside the house with a mask on her face the whole day. Mm-hmm. So the following day, she told me that she feel ill after done do her hair or whatever. So next day, she come and told me that she tested positive for COVID. And mm-hmm. it was like, oh, well, I said, well, I'm going to get tested too. Mm-hmm. I wasn't feeling sick or anything like that. But 2 days after, I started to feel ill. I couldn't breathe or nothing properly. So my mother took me to the hospital to get a COVID test. And I took the COVID test. And I came back positive. Mm-hmm. So.
And baby?
My son didn't get a test, but it's only the hospital we kept positive that he was positive to come here together. So, but then mm-hmm. don't give the baby COVID-19 tests.
Well, they do. You probably didn't get one, but that's another discussion.
Where I went, they don't give the babies.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So, what were your symptoms like, and how long did it last for you?
I couldn't taste or smell for like 10 days, mm-hmm. and I couldn't breathe at all. I couldn't breathe properly at all. My chest was tight. I was vomiting. I was pooling. I had a horrible headache for like 9 days. I had to take Advil gels. It was so horrible. So horrible. COVID is real.
And you weren't vaccinated. You're not vaccinated, are you?
No, I'm not vaccinated as yet. I'm going to get vaccinated in the next 3 months.
So any reason why you weren't thinking of a vaccine before, or you just weren't thinking about it?
I just wasn't ready yet. That's all. I just wanted to see how it worked on people before I take it.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think are some of the reasons why the younger generation is skeptical or don't really want to take it? Like when you hear from your friends and they don't want to take the vaccine,
because
what are some of their fears?
That the vaccine killing people, and they put their blood clots in your body, and they got a tracking device in it. Same sort of thing. So that's why the young people don't want to take it. But I am encouraging the young people to take the vaccine so you all won't be symptomatic. Because when you take the vaccine, you won't get as much symptoms as you're getting now. Mm-hmm. And it's not a cure, but it will prevent you from getting sick or even dying.
Dying from it. So that is your understanding. Do you think that when it comes to reaching out to the younger people, the people who are responsible for the communications to younger people, is there something more that they can do to reach out to y'all? Because there are press conferences all the time. Y'all don't really watch TV that much. What else can we do to get the message across to people in your age group? Because again, you are 19 years old. What can the government do? What can the COVID advisor do? What can CBC do? In order to get information out to people in your age group?
I feel you also just talk to the people and let them know that COVID is real, because people didn't know how real COVID is until they catch it, you know, because I used to say that COVID is just a joke and it's just a cool, and until they catch it and they realize how serious COVID really is. So I really encourage the people to get the vaccine for real, the young people, the middle-aged people, the old people. I just encourage everybody to take the vaccine, because this COVID-19 thing is not no joke.
Okay, but now one of the reasons why you're also calling to, Brittany, you're not working. You told us you don't want to go back into that business of being an exotic dancer. You told all of us that it makes you feel dirty. And you don't want to. You want better for yourself and for your son. And again,
yes, please.
Hunter, respect.
Because it's only my one, and it's only my one that is take care of myself before a job, and it is very, very hard on me. Mm-hmm. Yeah, my family has helped me, but I want to be able to help myself.
I know, and I understand. So I'm hoping that during this show, by the end of this show, and that people don't judge Brittany. I know there's some people who will, but I can tell you, Brittany, again, I have 101% respect for you for coming and saying your position. You've shown that you got some guts, but you're also here because you are in need. Brittany is in need of a job, and Brittany wants to work in order to make herself better. And for those of you listening and watching, please understand that yes, she was an exotic dancer, but also understand that Brittany does not want to do that anymore, and that is something that she doesn't want for her son to grow up knowing. And you're hoping that we can appeal to you for some help. We'll be back after the break. Brittany, I hope your phone doesn't cut out on you, but we'll be back after the break. Welcome back to Face It and Fix It. We're speaking with Brittany. Brittany, you're still on the line?
Yes, please.
Brittany, well, someone messaged me. Well, we don't know. We're not here to say that we're going to be able to help you 100% because it all depends on our viewers, our listeners, and people who want to reach out to us. I know that you are looking for a job. I'm pleading with Barbadians who are listening to Brittany right now that she is a single mom of a 10-month-old baby boy. She's 19 years old. She's confessed that in the past she might have been dancing a little bit and it was a job, and no shame in that, but she also wants to change her life and she's asking for a job, which we, by the way, we can give you details if you contact us in the show afterwards or you can contact me. I can tell you that the people who I get clothes from call Planet Fashions in Baltimore Gap. You're free to go there and we'll get you an outfit there for your interview. And I can also tell you that our another friend by the name of Brittany as well, Brittany Braffitt, PR consultant, will also be having a conversation with you after the show and to point you in the right direction with training and some skills and things that you may need. Anything you want to tell us quickly, Brittany, to Barbadians listening to you, 19 years old, you're in the middle of a pandemic, you're unemployed. What do you want to tell us listening to you right now?
I just want to tell everybody that it's really hard, life is hard, and you just got to take it one step at a time and just go by the flow.
Okay, and what about the little boy and yourself? I just want to ask you a question. You said you were in isolation, but there was something that happened that you didn't fully understand. You got tested for COVID, but have you been retested?
No, please. In 14 days, you'll be off in 14 days.
Okay, so basically, when you got the phone call that when you found out you were positive, you were in home isolation and not.
Yeah.
Okay. Huh? And how long has it been?
It's been 16 days now.
Oh, you've been at home for 16 days?
Yeah.
So no one called you to say?
No. No one didn't call.
Okay. No one called you for the 16 days since you got diagnosed?
No, please.
Okay. Well, after the show, I guess we're going to have to make a phone call. I mean, I know it's been a strain on the people who set up the home isolation and things can happen, but like a good girl, you stayed home though, right, Brittany?
Mm-hmm.
You stayed home for the last 16 days, right?
Yes, please.
Okay. What I'm going to do, we have your number. Brittany, I'm hoping that our viewers and listeners will reach out to you a little bit, but I do know at least as far as getting close for an interview and getting ready for an interview, people can contact me or the show and we can discuss what Brittany can do. And I'm asking Barbadians to do not judge anyone. Don't judge Brittany based on her past. She is looking forward to her future. And if you can reach out and help her so she can help herself and her little boy, my apologies, he's 10 months, we would all really appreciate it. Okay, so Brittany, thank you so much for taking the time for calling. Thank you for being brave and for sharing your past and your story of being at home with COVID. And we will call the COVID hotline on your behalf because I think after 16 days, someone should call you and let you know if you are COVID-free and free to go. Okay?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, my darling. You take care. We'll talk soon.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Okay, thank you too. All right. That was Brittany. Wouldn't call her last name, but again, making an appeal. We have making an appeal. We're making an appeal to the public. If you know someone, if you yourself, you're listening and you do have a job, again, you can contact us or contact me, 836-4629. Let us know how you can help Brittany, and we'll take it from there. We do have a caller in the line. Good morning, Face It and Fix It.
Hi, good morning. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. How are you?
I'm good. And yourself?
Not too bad. So how can we help you this morning?
I didn't hear you said just now.
How can we help you this morning?
This morning I'm calling in because I am a qualified student. I have studied at the university level and have been applying for work but not being able to be employed. And this is going on 3 years now. So I decided to call onto the program to just hear how it has been being unemployed, going through the interview process, but still ending up being unemployed and a bit depressed about it because it's been a while. So that's why I'm here today.
So what kind of job are you looking for? I mean, you said you're qualified,
yes,
but everywhere you went for the last 3 years, nothing?
Yeah, I have applied to both public and private positions in Barbados, and either not getting a call back or just making it to the interview process, and that would have been it. But my passion is I want to start my career in teaching, and be trying all the steps I could to get into that career path, but applying to where I'm supposed to apply for.
You mind if I ask you, how old are you?
I'm 31.
Okay. And you want to... Okay, go ahead. So you haven't worked in, what, 3 years, or you work part-time?
Before, I have worked part-time, and then I was looking for a full-time employment.
Okay, so this is... You think this is because of the pandemic, or you're talking about before as well? Because I think you said...
Before, and into the pandemic.
Which is worse now. So what do you find is the problem? I mean, you say you go to the interviews. Is it that you apply for jobs that you see online or in a newspaper, or you just apply to places at random? Because that could be a problem when people apply to places, and obviously they're going to get a no if there's no vacancies.
I see advertised for vacancies.
Mm-hmm. And you said you want to teach?
Yes, I do.
Have you been to Erdiston as yet?
No, please, I'm not there as yet. I would have waiting to apply to get in for teaching, but I'm not sure why I haven't gotten yet.
Well, there are private schools as well. And to, again, viewers and listeners, this is yet another person who would like your assistance. And we know there are a lot of unemployed people right now in the country because of COVID-19, but we do have to find our way back out of this situation. Some people can be self-employed and others can need some help. We will take your information. I believe we do have it with the phone calls coming in, and we will speak to you off air. And hopefully we have people who will reach out and ask, who's that girl and what can she do? And the other one too as well, Brittany. So hopefully we get people reaching out. This is the time that we need to come together. We need to come together and we need to help each other as best as we possibly can. And this is what this show is all about too as well, helping each other out and the agencies coming forward and helping with issues. We'll be back after the break. Welcome back to Face It and Fix It, and we do have a couple more minutes left in the show, and I want to share some of my concerns, not really COVID-related, but related to the way we are behaving. I've seen a couple of videos over the last couple of days, one in particular yesterday, and people were talking about the government, one lady, and about people not giving you a chance to voice your opinion, people not feeling as if they're being heard, all kinds of things. People are walking out of sessions that we saw yesterday with Senator Caswell Franklin, and people have a right to stand up and for what they believe in. But I think we just need to be really careful about who we listen to and the kind of things that we follow. There is freedom of speech, but there's something called responsible freedom of speech. There's standing up for what you believe in, and that's correct. But there are people who stand up for what they believe in, not because they care about you, it's because they care about themselves. And sometimes that we find people following people, and not necessarily for the right things. Now, we do have a government, and like we do always, you know, every 5 years or 4 years, there's an election. We do have to respect the office, regardless as if you voted for people or not. but we are in a pandemic, which also means that as much as possible, we do have to work with government, regardless of how you voted, because we are in this pandemic and we are in this together. I know this sounds cliche, but literally, we're in this together. We depend on each other. In order to survive, we depend on each other as neighbors. We depend on each other for food, even though we may not do it directly. If we don't work, if we don't import things, if we don't stimulate the economy, the whole thing crumbles and then everybody crumbles. So I was a little taken back with some of the comments that we're hearing all of the time, and it just all falls into this political, all based on politics, the pandemic politics, something happens politics, somebody didn't do this politics, and then we're just spinning around in circles. So I'm hopeful. I can't tell you what to do, but I'm hoping to encourage you as much as possible. Put politics aside. We really are in this together. Prime ministers come and they go. MPs come and they go. They're just people. They've been put into office to help us. But we can't just sit here and wait for everything to happen. We have to help them too, including that of an opposition. So I'm hoping to see everybody get together and work on how best we can get jobs, how best we can encourage tourism again, how best we can put things in place that we don't have to solely depend on tourism. How can we help people like Brittany, who just called, and that other young lady who's unemployed? Are these the real issues? Are these the issues that we should be losing sleep over? Whether or not someone is eating is the issue. Whether we install a person as a governor general or call them a president and their duties don't change, but we're changing the name, should that really be the topic of discussion? I'm not saying that you're not supposed to weigh in. I'm not saying that things shouldn't be done the right way. But when you sit down and you break it down, break it down. People like Brittany who just called and people like that girl who just called, and there are hundreds of you out there that you want chance, you want work, you want your children to eat, you want things, or like you want to be somebody, you want to do things. How can things like that take priority to make a big song and dance? So we had the installation, great. I think it's wonderful. I think that we're independent and we should complete it and complete the process. And we did that. But should we made a big song and dance over the process? In my humble opinion, no. Should we make a big song and dance over unemployment? Yes. Should we make a big song and dance over people who are being molested and children who were, we saw in one video being maybe attacked and criminals around the street sometimes, and the poor police are trying their best to get a handle on it. Aren't those the things that we should be more focused on instead of the small things? So I'm urging Barbadians, life's short. Shorter than you think. And we wake up every day and we don't know what the day can bring, but we're just so grateful to see it. And when we get up, hopefully we can make some sort of a difference. Make a list of all the things that you want to do and all the things that you could do for somebody else. And you can't get through all of them in the whole course of the day, but make a start. And try to prioritize about what is important, not only just for you, but for this country. Is it really the installation of a president, which we are just going to do? And that's okay. We did it. Should we make a big song and dance? No. Should we make a big song and dance for small things and who says what, who says this? No. But I encourage you, make a big song and dance for employment. Make a big song and dance for healthcare. Make a big song and dance for education. And make sure that we all do what we can for each other. I want to thank all of our guests. I want to thank our viewers and our listeners. And until God... should God spare our lives and my life, I hope to see you again on Monday. Take care and stay safe. Bye for now.